Well, it's outstanding to be here again to have the opportunity to share the unvarnished truth, which is the only truth there really is. There's a great contagion on the planet right now, and that's contagion, lack of truth, lack of true teaching. It is the worst epidemic in history, as a matter of fact. Take all the epidemics, all the troubles in the world, put them all into one, and it's still not as bad as this contagion. The lack of true teaching on this planet is absolutely astonishing. It's getting passed on from parent to child, from parent to child, to parent to child. Schooling reinforces it. All ideology of the world just reinforces it, cradle to grave, like an assembly line. The true teaching is not being taught in this world except for very, very, very minimal. And even that is getting compromised. The fact is that we are, even though we may seem that we're light years away from realization, we are right on the very edge of it at all times. We are very, very close to it. And I have to remind myself and all of you of that fact as I go about the day. I think, oh my gosh, I'm going to fail. There's no way I'm going to succeed. It's just I can't get it. And then I realize, no, wait a minute. I'm right there. I almost have it. So it can feel like you don't have a clue. Why? Because we keep forgetting what the truth is. And the truth is we don't need to do anything. There's nothing that needs to happen in existence in order for us to be saved. Nothing. And that will always be true. Always be true. It makes absolutely no difference what happens in existence. Whether humanity awakens or doesn't awaken makes no difference whatsoever. Absolutely no difference. Whatever happens in the world, in the universe, makes no difference to our salvation, the fact that it's present for us and effective for us to solve the continuity problem. Because the continuity problem is the only problem we have. Even if humanity, quote-unquote, awakens, the continuity problem still remains unsolved because it's only God's plan of salvation that works. It's not our plan. We keep trying to use our plan, okay? We keep trying to devise a plan. That is not it. The fact is, right here, right now, the perfect plan of God's plan of salvation is present and totally effective right now, which is God's complete, flawless, eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. That is it. So it doesn't matter what we do or don't do. Makes no difference. Again, God is not viewing our lives, is not micromanaging our lives, is not viewing our lives and saying, okay, what are they doing now? What are they doing now? God pays no attention whatsoever to what we're doing. And when we think, oh, that's terrible, we can't get any guidance. We don't need guidance except to God's non-judgment, perfect eternal non-judgment of hypotheticals. That is the only thing we need guidance to, and that's what the Holy Spirit does. So the Holy Spirit does micromanage our lives, but only to bring us to this present, ever-present, salvational, continuity, resolving, non-perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Forever and forever and forever and forever and ever and beyond that. Endlessly eternal, endless non-judgment, meaning it doesn't matter what we hypothesize, what if. It has no effect upon reality whatsoever. It never will. So one way to talk about this is a high indifference. God has this high indifference. Franklin Merrill Wolfe talked about this, how he said the highest state is this high indifference, which he, meaning reaching this unconditional non-judgment of the prime creator upon all hypotheticals. High indifference, total, complete indifference about anything here, in impermanence whatsoever. And what do you expect from the prime creator? Of course, that's what you would expect, to stand up for reality, or to say that reality doesn't even need to be stood up for. Reality doesn't need a hero. It's not in danger. It's not being threatened in any way. See, reality does not need a hero. Think about that. But we do need to be reminded of what we are. Okay, that's important. So we believe each day we go about our day, we think, oh my gosh, I can't get it. I don't understand it. It's too difficult. And we need to be reminded and reassured, no, it's not too difficult. It's simply we have to realize that our enlightenment, God is indifferent to that too. God pays no attention to our enlightenment. He's already given the remedy. The fact is that in this high indifference, we look out and we're looking upon everything external to that, all hypotheticals, and it doesn't matter whether you're enlightened or not enlightened. Again, makes no difference to this high indifference, this perfect and eternal, flawless, concurrent blessing of non-judgment. So whether really our salvation comes from giving up the quest for enlightenment, giving up the quest for anything to change, for anything to take place, good or bad, it comes from releasing all of that effort, all of that effort, all of that focus, all of that desire, all of that intensity for something to happen. Now, of course, in this universe, everything keeps on happening, but we don't have the desire for it to happen. We don't have to be attached to any happenings. Ananda Mahima would say, whatever happens doesn't make the slightest difference to me. She goes, let anything happen, doesn't matter. No difference. It doesn't affect me in the slightest bit. Whatever. She said, let whatever happen, happen. Doesn't matter. That's the true teaching. That is the true teaching. And ask ourselves, how many parents are passing that on to their children? Of course, children's values and belief systems are heavily, heavily, heavily guided by their parents, okay? Especially the mother, okay? And so, or in these days, it's the mother plus the television or the video, a smartphone, the video games, the, you know, schooling, that, you know, heavily, heavily. How much of that is directly and clearly pointing out this truth that absolutely nothing needs to happen? And it makes no difference what happens here. God's plan of salvation is not dependent on anything, any choosing of any particular hypotheticals. How often is that passed on? I've never come across a situation where that's passed on, never heard of a situation. It's like almost nil. Almost nil. So how is the world doing? Well, it's not doing very well. And again, does that make a difference? No. But the fact is, we think it makes a difference, which keeps us enmeshed in this effort to accomplish something, to do the right thing. See, to choose the right hypothetical, to manipulate, to build, to construct, to trim, to prune, to weed out, to change, to engineer, to balance, to try to do all this stuff, all complete waste of time, total waste of time. What was Ramana Maharshi trying to do? He's just sitting there, more silent than silence, you know. What's he trying to do? Not trying to do anything. He's just showing you this high indifference is not looking at anything you're doing. It makes absolutely no difference. So those who think we're being judged by God, that is not true. We're being non-judged by God, and we'll always be non-judged. So get over yourselves. The belief that you're being judged is just pride. How could God be judging his creation, his perfect creation? Doesn't he already know from the very beginning it's perfect? Of course. So there's absolutely no reason to judge whatsoever. The whole notion that God is judging us is spiritual pride, meaning that God is imperfect. It's an actual tacit statement that God is imperfect and is concerned about his creation, that something is amiss with it, which then justifies us replacing God. You see, we want to replace God with ourselves. Spirit wants to replace God as prime creator. And Spirit is trying to justify it, trying to figure out a way how to do that, and says, well, Spirit wants to say, well, God is imperfect, therefore God should be replaced because we're better. So the whole notion that God is judging any aspect of hypotheticals would mean that God is imperfect, because it would mean that God's will is not permanent, that reality isn't perfectly set and stable, that there's something is impermanent there, that hypotheticals somehow threaten it, you see? So that would mean that God is not perfect, is flawed. There's a flaw in reality. And therefore, God is judging hypotheticals, trying to say, well, no, get rid of that one. That one, we don't want that one. Oh, yeah, accept that one. That one's good. You know, Not true. Not true. That is 100% spiritual pride, which is the greatest, you know, quote unquote sin of all. Is and we don't realize that it is spiritual pride, but we have to come to that realization that it is spiritual pride. Meaning, God is imperfect. We are declaring it. We say, by this judgment of God upon us, that proves that God is imperfect, actually, because God is needing to judge God's creations and help them avoid pitfalls and all this stuff, right? Not true. God's creation is perfect, flawless. No need to judge whatsoever, and it always will be that way. So God is flawless. God is perfect. God does not need to be replaced, and we cannot replace God. So all this contingency plan of what we could is a waste of time. It's a waste of time. It's just a completely, time is a waste of time. As one of the viewers said, is quite right. Time is a waste of time. That is very, very true. It's a total waste of time, except the Holy Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit knows how to use time correctly. Only though we don't. We do not. So we should let go of time. Let the Holy Spirit, let go of our attachment to time, and let the Holy Spirit use time. In other words, do not pray for any outcome. Okay, do not pray for any outcome. I put a shade here. I guess it's a little too low. It comes into the picture just a little bit. But that adds a little flavor to the whole situation. Or I can always move it a little bit this way. Interesting. I'm going to keep the sun from hitting here, and having to change the lighting constantly is such a problem. Wow. I can fix that. Yeah. And I know a way. So I actually did something that's supposed to make this whole thing better. Now, this afternoon, I got off work a little early, and I could have played golf, or I could tape. And which one did I decide to do? I decided to tape. I said, forget it. Taping is more important. This, I enjoy it more than golf, actually. I get a sense of hope. Even though the hopeless can come on very quickly, right? It's easy to be hopeless right now, because we think we just can't make it. Just can't do it. For some reason, we can't do it. But there again, the answer is, it doesn't matter if we can't do it. Paradoxically, it doesn't matter if we fail. It doesn't matter what the personality, what the mind decides, personality decides, that makes no difference. It doesn't disturb this non-judgment. So it's, the safety is in this non-judgment, abiding in that non-judgment. Now, the personality structure and the world structure, everything else can be not abiding in it. That doesn't matter. We don't have to be enlightened, as it were, okay? We don't have to be saved. We don't have to be awake. And it's that shift that we're looking for, to that paradoxical shift, which is that the high indifference is not looking at us, is not looking for our enlightenment, or not looking for anything at all in hypotheticals. It's not looking for anything at all. So how can we fail? It's impossible to fail. Whether we're enlightened or not, we can abide in this perfect non-judgment. And looking out from that, it doesn't matter what we see. Do we see ourselves as enlightened or unenlightened? It doesn't matter. In other words, our judgments don't matter. And other people's judgments don't matter. It doesn't matter if we judge ourselves as enlightened. It doesn't matter. It does not matter. I still have to do a little adjustment here. Let me see. It does not matter what judgment we have upon ourselves. Whether we say, well, I'm enlightened. It doesn't matter. So giving up judgments are not even, it doesn't matter if we give up judgments or not. So we don't have to give up judgments. We just have to abide in God's non-judgment. So in other words, the issue of whether we're enlightened or not doesn't really matter. because that's a judgment. God is not judging whether we're enlightened or not. God knows we're perfect. God knows we're perfect and just reaffirmed this for us. So we get into this nebulous area, and yet this is the area that needs to be gotten into. And it probably helps to have somebody talking about it, because it seems so nebulous. You think, wow, can that possibly be it? You see, it doesn't matter if it's it or not. Nothing matters in hypothetical land. And yet, instead of dropping hypotheticals, which we feel is a continuity issue, what we do is we accept God's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. So that, in essence, in hypotheticals, I say, what if hypotheticals don't matter at all? That's still a what if. But we can maintain, you know, we can see everything in the world, but we just realize, hey, none of this matters at all. The destiny of hypotheticals doesn't matter at all. Paradise or hell doesn't matter. Good, bad, and different doesn't matter. And this borderland, this nebulous talk, this talk that seems paradoxical, which is the continuity into this true solution to the continuity issue we have. That's what it is. And so the teaching seems to reach a dead end almost. But in listening to it, we can kind of get a sense, we get familiar with it, like, wow, it doesn't really matter. And at some point, we'll be able to make this just a little shift in acceptance, and then it doesn't matter anymore what we've done or haven't done. In fact, it's never mattered. It's never mattered what we've done or haven't done. And it's never mattered what anyone's done or hasn't done. Never. Never, never, never. Not even for an instant. And that's the real freedom, the real wholeness, the real healing. The real safety. The true safety. Spirit, I am. I am a holy aspect of God. Free from limits, safe, healed and whole, free to forgive, free to save the world. That's a little affirmation from A Course in Miracles. And we're not trying to knit diversity together into unity, okay? Makes absolutely no difference. Whether there's diversity or whether there's unity makes no difference. Nothing matters in hypothetical land because it has no effect on reality whatsoever, none. And there's only reality is, so it's not affecting anything. It's not affecting anything. It's only a desire to affect reality, but it's not an actual effect on reality whatsoever. And it's frustrating to remember this because you think, well, how's this help me? You don't need to be helped. Nobody needs to be helped. Nothing needs to be helped except for this continuity issue. But the solution to the continuity issue is a blanket solution. So you see, nothing matters to complete perfect, flawless, eternal non-judgment. It doesn't matter. However anything is right now, that's just fine. That's perfect. Just as perfect as how it will be tomorrow or the next moment or as in the past. exactly the same, because it's the blanket non-judgment is upon, overlays how it is right this instant, as well as the next instant equally. It doesn't matter. So whether we wake up now or tomorrow or in a trillion years, none of it matters. It's the same blanket non-judgment upon the situation, always. So that's why we say, you know, enlightenment doesn't really matter, because we're putting enlightenment in time. Enlightenment is a realization that whatever happens in time doesn't matter. So we're automatically, when we think of anything, we're thinking of it in time. So when we say nothing matters, we mean nothing matters in time. Enlightenment, salvation, healing, all that stuff doesn't matter, because it's in time. And it's actually all spiritual pride, meaning that we need time because God is imperfect, that God is not perfect now, that God's non-judgment is not non-judgment now. And how can we be enlightened now? You see, we have to realize that we've always been enlightened. In other words, the continuity issue has always been solved. There's never been a point where it's not been solved. That's the true enlightenment, is that we've always had this with us and always will. Impossible not to have it. God's eternal, flawless, concurrent, non-judgment upon all hypotheticals has always been with us in hypothetical land. Never an instant that it wasn't with us. And it's always the same. It's always overlaying everything. Always will. So there's really nowhere that we can take it. And again, rejecting this truth is rejecting God. It's saying that God is not perfect. That God must have either been given this ahead of time or after we chose hypotheticals instead of concurrently. All right. The cat has arrived for satsang. Hey, probably not for satsang, but probably for food. Nothing has to happen. Nothing has to die. Nothing has to be born. Makes no difference what happens. So that means that the world can continue on. It doesn't make any difference. It's always been covered by perfect, flawless, eternal, and concurrent non-judgment of the Prime Creator. Everything, every little aspect, all impermanence, forever and forever, is covered. And this type of teaching is not often heard. I wish it was heard everywhere. Would make it a lot easier for us. I wish the culture reflected this. It doesn't. It doesn't. Culture is a disaster. But it really doesn't do any good to talk about how bad the culture is, and that doesn't do much good. It doesn't make it any better, that's for sure. And of course, it doesn't need to get better, does it? Because this culture is covered too by perfect non-judgment. But we're thinking, oh, but we want to make it better. So we don't want non-judgment upon this, because that means if we make it better, that doesn't mean anything. That is true. Making it better doesn't mean anything. Making it worse doesn't mean anything. So what do we do? What do? Is we focus in on these truths. I asked the Holy Spirit what to do, and the Holy Spirit said, why don't you tape? Put up a shade cloth and do some taping. I said, wow, that's what I do every day. And the Holy Spirit said, yeah, but put up a shade cloth so the sun isn't, you know, causing problems. And go ahead and tape. Try Ustream. It's earlier in the day. Maybe it won't drop out on you. And that way it's available to those who are having problems with YouTube. YouTube's getting very strange, I'll tell you. Very... Wow. Someday we may have to just go to the Ustream, you know? It's possible. Amazing. I mean, what's going on there? Amazing. Absolutely amazing. Watch a video. You go into your channel. They have all these videos for you. It says... we recommend this video is recommended for you because you watch this. So I listen to some song by some group, and then they always keep putting up this documentary with these horrible mugshots of that somehow they relate to the video I watched. And it's like, you know, gruesome stuff. I know a lot of the videos are very gruesome. I mean, I couldn't believe it. They put one up yesterday with some in Cambodia. The problems in Cambodia. And it was just most gruesome stuff you can imagine. And they just have it right there on your channel. As you go to your channel, that video's right there. You know, just think about that. And the mentality behind that. Who's doing the linking? What algorithms? What are they looking? They're obviously, because I don't watch that kind of stuff, gruesome stuff. And the link is completely tenuous. For instance, one of them, I listened to the song by the, what was it, the Crystals or something. Something produced by Phil Spector. It's a girl group back in the 60s. They keep putting up a documentary on Phil Spector showing his mugshots, which is horrible thing. That looks absolutely terrible. It's awful. And they say, well, we recommend this for you because you watch, you just listen to this song. I just wanted to get the lyrics of that song. The link is so utterly whimsical as to be ridiculous. And yet it has the thumbnails are like horrible. So much stuff of the thumbnails or the stuff that's recommended for me is gruesome and violent, horrible. It has nothing to do with what I watch at all. The opposite. So what's going on, you see? I've noticed more and more and more of this, that what is being recommended to me is very decadent. And I know for a fact this has absolutely nothing to do with what I watch. That's scary. Recommended for you. I guarantee you, as you already know, the world of what it's doing is your life is going to be recommended for you. Okay. This is your life we recommend for you. Who's we? You know, who is it? We don't know. Right? So it could be some fiend with some fiendish algorithms to make sure that you get the worst stuff possible. Could be someone who's terrified of God, terrified of salvation, who's making he wants to be surrounded by those who are also terrified of it to feel safe. I might have to take a break here. If I do, let me get a movie up here that you can watch. Just a second here. I can keep on talking probably. Yeah. So it is beyond frightening what's happening. Recommended for you. Here's what we think you should watch. And I'd say, my gosh, that's the last stuff I would want to watch. I don't want to watch that at all. Very great. We'll bring something up just in case I have to. This clip. So that's a good way to spend some time. We'll see. We will see. All right. So, do you want a world that is recommended to you, or do you want God's plan of salvation, which is indifferent to the world? One way or the other, doesn't matter. And this indifference is actually bliss. Deep, 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 deep bliss, calm. Unshakable calm and peace, unshakable peace. And it's truth, and it enables us to set down hypotheticals, because hypotheticals are absolutely horrible, because they're based on the premise of annihilation of reality, based on a fear-based premise. Instability, at best, really unstable. It's actually nothing at all, completely meaningless. It engenders conflict, fear, depression, separation, loneliness, death. Every horrible situation imaginable has to arise from hypotheticals. And even though we say hypothetically, we don't want that. It's still, hypotheticals are fear-based. We're saying, what if reality wasn't real? What if we could change reality? If we knew we couldn't change reality, we wouldn't engage in hypotheticals at all. Hypotheticals have absolutely nothing to offer us. Well, the sun has not yet struck the screen. We'll see what happens when it does. Maybe, I don't know what's going to happen. Maybe this is symbolic of being shaded from the harsh glare of this present world culture. You know, I put up with it last year and started this year, and the Holy Spirit said, put some shade up. Shade. Kept saying, shade, 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 shade. Come on. So, putting the shade up means the sun will be diffused and won't strike harshly. So I want to see what happens there. You see, Romano was not waiting for something to happen. Was not waiting for something to happen. Was not concerned with what has happened in the past, or what is going to happen, or what is happening now, or what is happening. Any happening doesn't matter. And simply told us the truth about the situation. So just give time for this seemingly paradoxical teaching to sink in at some level. And of course, sinking in isn't required either. It doesn't make any difference either. Tell yourself that. Just, you can tell yourself, this doesn't make any difference. Sinking in doesn't make any difference. This doesn't make any difference to my salvation. No matter what it is, you could say enlightenment doesn't make any difference to my salvation. Freedom doesn't make any difference to my salvation. Satsang doesn't make any difference to my salvation. My salvation is undisturbed even by my salvation. As you use concepts this way, you will find some sort of different type of reaction. It's like, wow. Uh-oh, the gardeners are here with their power equipment. Get ready for some commotion. Don't be in a hurry with realization, because realization doesn't matter to our salvation. Say that, realization doesn't matter for our salvation. Nothing matters for our salvation. Which means it's always been here. It's always been concurrent with hypotheticals. That's the key. Now is concurrent with time. So time isn't needed. Anything that can happen in time has never been needed. There we go with the machinery. It's never been needed. Never will be needed. We don't even need peace. Peace isn't needed. Quiet isn't needed. Quiet isn't needed. Peace isn't needed. Makes no difference to perfect and eternal concurrent non-judgment whether hypotheticals are peaceful or not peaceful. Makes no difference. Again, God gave no judgment upon content whatsoever of hypotheticals, because God by giving no judgment, God is saying there is no content, which is true. There is no content. There is no content to nothing. We keep dressing up nothing, pretending that it has some content. It does not. So dressing up nothing as peace still has no content. So it's neither peaceful nor not peaceful. In other words, non-judgment, God's perfect non-judgment, is not saying that it's peaceful, and it's not saying it's not peaceful, and it's not saying that it's a combination, or it's not saying it's not a combination, it's not saying anything at all. As to the nature of all permanence, doesn't have a nature. So nature has no nature to it. Empty of nature, devoid of all qualities, really. Don't be in a hurry. There's nowhere to go. Wherever we go, we're going nowhere. Wow, excuse me. Must be some dust kicked up. Wherever we go, we're going nowhere. Whatever we do, we're doing nothing. Whatever we say, we're saying nothing. Nature has no qualities, or it's devoid of anything. It's empty. And yet this abiding in this emptiness, as it were, nature, seeing it's devoid of any in reality, it reminds us of reality because it's all one, all the same, no judgment. So reality doesn't need to be judged. Reality's all one, it's all the same. It's all a totality. There's no judgment taking place at all. So that reminds us it's of reality. Well, the sun is coming. I'm trying to look. There's it. Yeah. Don't be in a hurry here. There's nowhere that we need to go. Nothing that we need to do. We're already saved. Everything is already saved. Everything is already saved. Because the nothingness of everything stands revealed. God's perfect non-judgment reveals the nothingness of all impermanence, the equal nothingness of it. There's nothing that's more nothing, and there's nothing that's less nothing. It's all equally nothing. Okay, so the cat is hanging out now, but I have a feeling that it's only here for the sunlight, you know, the warm sunlight. Maybe that's its way of saying it doesn't need to do anything. Don't be in a hurry. We're in no hurry here. There's nothing to get. There's nothing to get. Even the getting is empty. It's nothing. Only the concurrency. Only the concurrency is what's crucial. Only concurrency. Only the concurrency. And that concurrency is right now. So you can't get it in time. Because in time, it's looking back towards the moment that just passed and saying it wasn't there, but that's why I'm here now. It wasn't there before. But then it's not concurrent. So really, concurrency is the key term. If you want to talk about any term, concurrency is the key term. Salvation is concurrent with damnation. Damnation means to entertain hypotheticals. Wherever you are, be relaxed. Don't be in a hurry. Don't be trying to grab a hold of something. Because concurrency, it's already here. You don't need, no need for any grabbing. Time never was without non-judgment. So time never really was at all. The whole meaning of time is that it's necessary, that there was something, some reason for it. There was no reason for it. It's not necessary. It's not necessary for time to touch anything. You might say the vision of oneness is seeing everything untouched by time. Seeing everything as touched by non-judgment. And so, don't be in a hurry. Time is saying, hey, gotta be in a hurry with this. Gotta make time quicker. Get closer. Now there's no closeness. See, we're not looking for closeness. We could say we're always totally close because there is no closeness. So we're not looking for closeness at all. We're not looking for distance either. Neither close nor far away. Neither close nor far away. So we're not looking for any spatial situation at all. No time situation, no spatial situation. So that means we don't need looking at all. Because what can we look upon except time and space? We're not looking for time and space. Non-judgment is not built on a foundation of time and space. It's been built on the foundation of concurrency. Concurrency with time and space, but not on the foundation of time and space. In other words, time and space did not come first, and then God's non-judgment came second. No, it was concurrent. It's not built on the foundation of time and space. Don't be in a hurry. The assumption is that we need to be motivated to look upon something, find something, to look something. To get something, there's nothing to get. Concurrency is right now. It's always been. Don't be in a hurry. Don't let your mind push you into a hurry. Like you've got to figure it out right now. There's nothing to figure out. So, figuring is a measurement, right? It's a distance. How far? What's the distance? What's the height? What's the width? What's the distance? What's the time interval? What's the time interval? That's all measurement, whether it's time, measuring time, or measuring space. But concurrency What's there to measure in concurrency? So it's like we need to shift from measurement to non-measurement. And that's what we're all struggling with. The vision of Christ might be said to be in the non-measure, the vision of non-measurement. Nothing, you're viewing everything not from a standpoint of how does it measure up. No measurement. Which is what people call isness. The vision of isness is the same thing as the vision of non-measurement, which is the same thing as the vision of non-judgment, which is the same as the vision of oneness, the vision of Christ. The vision of the overlay, nirvana, samadhi, vision of non-judgment, vision of non-measurement, vision of isness. And of course, we can't measure that. What we want to do is say, oh, that's great. So how do we measure this vision of isness? How does it measure up? It's not asking to measure up. It's not asking to be measured. Or how does it measure up? Don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry to measure anything. Everything that we're perceiving is measured. We don't realize that we are constantly measuring and calculating time and space. So we don't see anything in its unmeasured aspect. In its non-judged aspect. It's not, we don't see anything. Our perception is we're viewing measurement. We look at something, there's over-there-ness attached to what it is. There's size-ness, there's seasonalness, there's colorness, there's everything is a measurement. But the one thing that we can't measure is isness. You know, the German philosopher said there's no thing in itself. That is entirely untrue. Isness is everything in itself. The non-judgment of God upon all hypotheticals is this thing in itselfness. Everything is non-judged. There's no need to measure it against anything else. So everything has this isness, is thing in itselfness. So this plant is not being measured with other plants, with other things, either in time or in space, or any qualities being measured. It is totally independent of any time or spatial qualities or relationships. That's why I call it the overlay, is because you can still see everything spatially and temporally to function, and yet you can also experience the isness, which is a feeling that doesn't come about through measurement. Measuring the qualities of time and space. That's why Ananda Maima said, she didn't see with the body's eyes. She didn't need to see with the body's eyes. And at nighttime, she said everything was just as bright as daytime to her. She could watch it walk in the pitch dark. You put a hood over her eyes, it wouldn't make any difference. She said she's not using her body's eyes to see at all. It's a different perception. Or you can seeing the isness, vision of isness. And everything is equally is, equally unjudged. It's not in relationship with anything else, spatial, temporal relationship. It's in relationship with equal non-judgment. We're not supposed to be struggling for a relationship. We're supposed to be abiding in non-judgment, which is the only true relationship there is in hypotheticals. This unjudged isness, thing in itselfness, is the safe, healed, and whole perception. And when we finally accept it, then that's what we experience. We don't accept it because, again, there's enormous ignorance of it, meaning ignoring it. We're not used to it. We haven't got enough familiarity with it. But theoretically, it's already here. In other words, it doesn't matter what time's take on it is. What we're doing is we're paying attention to time and measurements take on non-judgment, which is totally beside the point. And at some point we'll realize it's beside the point. You see, God's non-judgment is the take upon everything, and it informs everything. Everything is as it is. Everything is thing in itselfness, unjudged in relationship to anything else. Everything there is totally pristine, right? There's this feeling of total freshness, totally pristineness. Okay, that is the gospel, the good news of salvation. It's not for time and space to judge or bless God's blessing. Which is why I think the Pope got it backwards, the new Pope Francis. He asked for the blessing from the congregation to him first. That's backwards. That's like asking for the blessings of space and time and measurement upon non-judgment and thing in itselfness and isness. That's the mistake we're making. That's the mistake we're making. We're waiting for that blessing, which will never come. That's the mistake we're making. Don't ask the world to bless us. Instead, bless the world with accepting non-judgment. And then everything is thing in itself. Imagine the freedom. That's what, when Jesus says, save the world, that's what he's talking about. Spirit am I, holy Son of God, free from limits, safe, healed, and whole, free to forgive, free to save the world. All right, that is what Jesus is talking about. And we are free to save the world by accepting this non-judgment upon the world, and then everything is thing in itself, which is free. The world has been freed. The world has been saved. Imagine the liberation, freedom of relief from everything. That it's not being judged in relationship to everything else. It's not being measured in time and space. Imagine the freshness. Imagine the sparkle. Imagine the joy, the bliss of everything, that you accept that for the world. You save the world. You're a world savior. You save the world when you accept that. Thing in itselfness. No judgment, see. And again, we've been pounding into our minds from Aristotle up to all of the German philosophers, which are responsible for our educational system, that there is no thing in itselfness. That's like an a priori premise of all our education, all our culture that we live in, this moribund, death-based culture we live in, this pathetic, farcical tragedy that we live in, that is studiously ignoring truth and salvation and throwing up anything and everything, hoping it will stick as something else, some substitute for it. Thing in itselfness absolutely is salvation. There's no thing in itselfness for time or space, in time or space, right? Of course. That would be impossible. So they should have said there's no thing in itselfness in time and space, but in God, but we don't need time and space. We need God's non-judgment, concurrent non-judgment upon time and space, which makes everything in time and space thing in itselfness, not needing any spatial relationship, not needing any temporal relationship at all to be non-judged, to be the isness, to have the isness present, to be overlaid with this isness. So everything would take on this absolutely charming quality to it. So precious, a completely precious quality. Everything equally precious. Not because of its spatial and temporal nature, but because of its unjudged nature. You see, it's not part of some space and time measurement relationship situation, dynamics of change and impermanence. It's not. It's unjudged. I wish Ramana were here right now so we could just sit with him and we'd get it. I'm sure we'd get it quite quickly. But the problem is right now is how would we travel to where he is? A travel is becoming extremely problematical and distasteful and expensive, and there's only privileged people can really do that, you know, at least who are financially privileged and or have gamed the system some way or somehow. We have the technology now for people to be aware, regardless of where they are, without the need to travel. I mean, even if Ramana were in India, I couldn't travel there. It wouldn't do me any good. It takes a certain type of hardiness to travel. I don't have that. There's no way. No way. It's enough for me to go down to the market. That's about it. So, I couldn't travel there. But hopefully, we'll be able to get it without having to do that. It seems like it's possible. That's the idea of these videos here, is we're working towards being able to transmit this truth so that anyone in the world can watch it without having to the extreme burden of trying to uproot their lives. I mean, who can, I don't know, this is amazing. Some people have gamed the system in some way, but they don't realize that there's a price to that too. But I mean, who can take time off to go, you know, and spend, 6 months sitting? Who can do that? I can't even take one day off. I took like 1 hour off today to do this taping. So there's a practical situation in the world right now. Practically speaking, it's so different than it used to be. So give it everything you've got here. Let's give it everything we've got here. Make it work here. Regardless of that leaf blower. Regardless of that leaf blower. We can talk right over that leaf blower, can't we? See? The leaf blower is like the world, isn't it? The sun, which is close to hitting, is like the world. The leaf blower is like the world, you see? And we're continuing to talk. Not intimidated by the world, you see? The world is making frantic efforts to improve itself. And we know this is not the answer. The harsh heat of recommendation for you, this is what we recommend for you, is trying to hit us and cause us all problems. We put up a shade cloth over that, you see. We don't care what's recommended for us. We'll choose our own, how we use our time here. We'll choose that, or we'll let the Holy Spirit choose it. So the Holy Spirit, for me, it says, do the taping. Come on, do the taping. You don't need to play golf. Go do the taping. So I say, okay, sounds good to me. The leaf blowers are ready to head for the hills, head out into their next leaf blowing mission. They're trying to clean up all the leaves. They don't want anyone to leave. No leavers. We can't have any leavers here in the world, can we? Can't have any relocators, any leavers. Practically, from a pragmatic standpoint, leaving may very well be the right move. Relocation. Exodus. Don't think Exodus won't happen. It happened supposedly in Egypt. I mean, it did. The Jews left Egypt. I said, let's get out of here. It's getting bad for us. Moses was warned in a dream or something, hey, you need to get out of Egypt here. Big problems are coming for you. So he said, let's go. Let's get out of Egypt. There's lots of exoduses that have happened throughout history. And the greatest exodus of all is coming up. Because the world that's being recommended for us here is not what we want. That's not the world we want. We want situations of support. The realization we've been talking about here, the acceptance of the isness, of the unmeasured, unrelated isness of God's perfect, concurrent, and eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. But we want that. We want to be able to not be in a hurry to get that. Just to say, because being in a hurry is counterproductive, isn't it? Because the isness is not in a hurry. Non-judgment is not in a hurry. It's already present. It's already present. It's not something we're chasing. It's not running away from us. And isness is not in a hurry to be something. It already is. It's not concerned about everything else, because in this vision, everything is thing in itself, isness, unmeasuredness, unjudgedness, just as it is. Doesn't have to be anything different than it is. Doesn't have to stop being what it is. This moment doesn't need to be some other moment. Each moment is fresh and clean, untouched by the next moment we choose. Everything is thing in itselfness. And no hurry. You see those leaf blowers, they come in like social services, kicking down your door and do their thing, collect all the leaves, and gone, the next place. The only changes here with this lighting is that as the sun lowers, it will come directly through, and it won't hit directly, but it will increase the amount of light. That is true. So I hadn't thought of that, but it will increase it. It'll be uniform though. So don't be in a hurry. Don't be in a hurry. Don't say, where's the end of this video? Where's the end? We're not looking for an end to this video. That's the importance of it, okay? That's the importance of these videos. We're not looking for an end. Okay, what's the end of it? I don't have any end in mind. Don't be in a hurry for an ending. Don't be looking for an ending. Remember, non-judgment is concurrent. It's always been with hypotheticals. There's no story to it. There is no story to it. The full story is that there is no story to it. The full picture is that there is no picture to it. The end is the realization there is no end. The trigger for it is the realization there is no trigger for it. There is no trigger for it. And you can try playing with these self-canceling statements like that, seemingly, and find one that affects you, that's powerful. You know, that's your mantra for right now. That's your mantra. Find your own mantra. You can do it. The mantras I suggest are not necessarily what is most powerful for you. So find your own mantra, but you have to actually experiment and think about it. See, for instance, one of the viewers suggested their mantra is, time is a waste of time. See, that's a very powerful mantra. And for them, that may be a very powerful mantra. Time is a waste of time. See, that's it. See? So find your own mantra. For me, the one that works seems to work powerfully. The trigger is that there is no trigger. The trigger is that there is no trigger. And that kind of gives this like, woo, feeling like, wow, where am I? So literally practicing these seemingly paradoxical statements is extremely helpful to you, to us. It's the medicine that needs to be taken right now, because the world is very clamped to the... It is quantum madness in the world right now. The world is recommending quantum madness for us. Because you watched this, we recommend quantum madness for you. Gee, thanks. That's called becoming smart. Quantum madness is because it's quantum, it must be smart, right? Oh, whoa, it's quantum madness. They forgot that part. Oh, well, you know, why worry about that? It's like someone saying smart stupidity. I mean, the world is very smartly stupid. I say it, sophisticated savages is what we have here in this world. Sophisticated savages. Sophisticated savagery. We have sophisticated savagery. We can go into any movie theater in the world and watch sophisticated savagery and think, wow, we're really, really smartly stupid. Something is blooming. There's fragrance. I don't know what that fragrance is coming, where that's coming from. Very, very beautiful fragrance here. Jasmine's not blooming. What a day in California, folks. Really, it's 100% spring. There's no taste of winter here today whatsoever. Whatsoever. I mean, it is gone. Again, don't be in a hurry. We're not trying to find an ending to this. Practice that. The reason why these videos are so long is so you can practice not trying to find an ending. Because what ending does perfect and concurrent eternal non-judgment have? It's already the ending. The ending is at the beginning. The ending and the beginning are one. That's another mantra. Jesus uses this one in A Course in Miracles. The ending and the beginning are one. Because perfect non-judgment is the ending to all hypotheticals, and it was put there concurrently with the beginning of hypotheticals. So from its very beginning, it's been the ending. The ending is always the ending. It's been there from the very beginning. The ending and the beginning are one. Don't be in a hurry. See, it takes a lot of guts to do this type of video. A lot of guts. People don't realize that. It's taxing my nerves, you know, overtaxing my nerves because these videos are so long. We're not trying to come to an ending. We're not trying to find an ending at all. And that is the very powerful teaching. Whereas you have these small video, 10 minutes, 5 minutes, and you have a satsang, 5 minutes. You say, oh, great, got to the ending, wrapped it up. The person's out of the stool, and okay, we reach the ending. Wonderful. But there is no ending to reach. The ending and the beginning are one. The ending is always present. Therefore, how can it be reached? You see. So we must practice not reaching an ending, as it were, or not in a hurry to reach an ending. Because the realization is that the ending is always present. Now is the ending to time, always. But it's always been concurrent. So it's not applying itself to time, you see. It's concurrent with time, like parallel, concurrent. It's not attacking time. It's not a reaction to time. It's not a preemption of time. It's a concurrency with time. Don't be in a hurry. Feel this unhurriedness. You don't even need to be in a hurry to feel unhurriedness. My judgment is not in a hurry. Thing in itselfness is not in a hurry. What's it in a hurry for? It already is what it is. Perfect non-judgment was always perfect non-judgment from the very beginning. So it's not in a hurry to become perfect, eternal, concurrent, flawless non-judgment. It's not in a hurry to become that. Being is not in a hurry to become something. We may think that nature's in a hurry to realize this truth, but no, that's not it. We are not trying to realize it from the standpoint of time and space. We're saying that time and space cannot realize anything. Therefore, everything in time and space, we simply accept the isness, the thing in itselfness of everything within time and space, even time and space itself, the isness, thing in itselfness of that too. Right now, always, but right now. And so all we're doing is we're practicing this, we're practicing it. From a mid-level guru, mid-level teacher, from one who is still not in, aware, not abiding in that. See, I'm not claiming to be abiding in that. I'm making the efforts here, along with the others who are watching it. Well, together we're making these efforts to let go of effort. We're practicing, like, abiding without effort, abiding in the effortless, the effortless state, thing in itselfness. See, everything thing in itselfness, nothing needs to become something. Nothing needs to be in a hurry for any reason. Everything's already arrived. To use a figure of speech, it never really had to go anywhere. It's been concurrent. So beautiful breeze. What a day. What a day. My gosh. Tempting to say, let's go out and golf on this day. Everything will be like glistening and sharp and beautiful. But this is better. This is way better. Again, the mind is saying, okay, well, how do we wrap this up? There's no wrap-up. There is no wrap-up. We're not looking for a wrap-up. Vision of non-judgment, the thing in itself, isness, is not trying to wrap itself up, but it inherently does so simply by not trying to do so. In other words, it reminds us of reality. Reality is not trying to come to an end. See, it's a paradoxical. By seeing that which is not trying to come to an end, we then are willing to set it down, willing for it to come to an end. But it doesn't, it's set down. It's not coming to an end. We set it down, we don't need it anymore. We don't need hypotheticals. Because it reminds us of reality. Reality is not trying to come to an end. It's not trying to wrap itself up. So when you see thing in itselfness, you realize, oh my God, nothing is trying to come to an end. I don't see any ending anywhere. So, okay, I hear that, okay. Not in any hurry. Don't need to bring anything to an end. Paradoxically, by seeing that which is not, which can't have a meaningful end to it because everything is thing in itself, what meaning would an end to it have? Wouldn't have any meaning. So by seeing no meaning to coming to an end, we're reminded of reality, right? Because reality never comes to an end. Hopefully sometime we can do these live, people can listen on Ustream. The reason I post them to YouTube is there's no commercials, whereas on Ustream you get hit with these commercials, which is quite annoying. Quite annoying. So this paradoxicality is having real teeth here, is that by seeing the vision of no endness, that brings an end, that brings an end to the necessity to see hypotheticals altogether. Because the continuity issue has been solved for us by the Prime Creator. Seeing something that is familiar enough to reality, where we don't feel any worry about a break in continuity, to set down all hypotheticals. Of course, we have to see a vision of nothing coming to an end. Perfect thing in itselfness, perfect isness, perfect thing in itself, mean no relation in time and space, no nature in time and space whatsoever. Therefore, how can it come to an end? How can it be said to come to an end? In relationship to what? Each moment, its isness is apparent. Its non-measuredness is apparent. So there's the vision of death-freeness, the vision of there's no death in that, so to speak of. Maybe that's why Jesus said we're misperceiving everything coming to an end here. With perfect non-judgment, it doesn't appear that way at all. So the thing in itselfness can't come to an end. The nowness of each moment can't come to an end. Even the absence is thing in itselfness. Absence in itselfness. That's why Nanda Mama said she saw absolutely no difference between life and death. None. She said it's all the same. It's all the same. One is the manifest, one is the unmanifest. No judgment upon any of that. No measurement of any of it. All thing in itselfness, isness. Okay, that's the sun's hitting my face. So it does lighten things up, but it's more of a uniform type of lighting. I don't know how effective it's going to be actually, because there's going to be shadows on the screen, which is going to make it blotchy as well, but oh well. Less glare, that's for sure. Again, don't be in a hurry for any ending. Very paradoxical. You see, we want existence to end. We want suffering to end. We want an ending. What we don't see is our desire for an ending is causing the suffering. We keep thinking, I want this pain and suffering and misery to end. We don't realize it's our desire for an ending that is causing the suffering and misery. So we think when someone says, well, don't desire for your suffering to come to an end. We think that's crazy. What are you talking about? That's crazy. But we don't realize that by giving up the desire for an ending, we give up suffering. That desiring an end is the suffering. It's desiring death. Give up your desire for death to come to an end, and where is death? You give up your desire for ending, where is death? There is no more death. How could there be? There's no more ending. That's why spiritual healers, they sound so paradoxical. You have a cancer, and you say, I'm praying for this cancer to come to an end. No, that's what caused the cancer, is praying for an ending. Praying for endings, an end. So instead of praying for an end, pray that you see no end to anything. That you see without an end. That which has no end. That which is not ending. Non-endingness. And in prayers for that, the cancer will dissolve, disappear. Because it's just symbolizing endingness. It's just, again, a symbol of coming to an end. All sickness will vanish when we give up desiring to see an end to anything. And stress will vanish and be replaced by bliss. The bliss of thing in itselfness, non-endingness. Which paradoxically enables us to then set down all symbols. Because the purpose of symbols is to symbolize ending. There's an end to reality. How can there be an end to reality? All we can do is symbolize it. But we can give a different purpose to symbols and decide, no, we don't want any symbols to end. We don't need any ending to symbols whatsoever. And then eventually, when the continuity problem has been overcome this way, then we can set all symbols down concurrently together. And then what meaning does an end to a symbol have if all set down together equally? Don't be in a hurry here. We say, okay, we got it, that's the end. No, we're not trying to find an end. Is it an end to the cancer? Well, the cancer was an end, a way to symbolize an end. You could say, well, is it an end to endings? Well, that's wordplay. It's the non-necessity for endings. So the cancer gives way, releases the necessity for it to be cancer. Because we were praying for an ending, now we're not praying for an ending anymore. So if we say, let there be no endings at all, no endings at all, that's bliss. That's timelessness. If there was absolutely nothing coming to an end at all, how could you say that there's time? Because let's say this here was still, and then I move it, that's the end to its stillness, right? That's time. Everything in time is there. Each moment is ending in time. No two moments are the same. So that there's an end. There's constant endings. So instead, we pray for vision of no endings, no endingness. Which would mean thing in itselfness. Each moment is a thing in itself. Is fresh and clear of every other moment. It's not that one moment ends and the next one begins like that. It's not that one moment causes the ending of another moment. It's that each moment is fresh. Complete in itself. Again, we're practicing not being in a hurry to find an ending to anything. See, the part of our mind that measures says, okay, got the measurement. There's an end to that. I've got it. I've measured it. Now I know what the measurement is. That's an end. Everything thing in itself, though, is not being measured. The unmeasured isness of it. Of course, this has been talked about many times before. But yet, this is our talking about it, our investigation of it. Because the world always thinks that it's bringing those to an end, endlessness to an end. And never more so than now. So, it's not like there's this easy continuity between realization of the of continuity of the path lineage to it, because the world is constantly reintroducing the notion of coming to an end that says this is a new era, this is a new time, you know, all this kind of stuff. This is a new age, you know, we're in a new age. And so that has such a profound grip upon us that we think we have to reassert the truth in the face of the current of ignoring it. It's like saying this is a new ignorance we have now. That's what it's really saying, that we have a new ignorance. No, it's not. It's the same ignorance. Now we have a new desire. No, it's the same desire. It's just repackaged. See, this world is constantly repackaging itself. God doesn't judge the packaging. And inside the package, there's nothing. So, since God, there's no use to judge the packaging, there's no use to judge at all. Don't be in a hurry. Hang in there. That is the teaching. Teaching is don't be in a hurry here. Because the mind is frantically searching for the finish. Where's the punchline so we can finish this off? That's in my mind. There's part that's like panicking. Say, okay, well, how do I finish this? How do I end this? You know, where's this going? Where's this leading? Where's the linearness? Where you know, where's the story here? Where how do you wrap it up? And I'm saying, no. The franticness saying, come on, you need to get the real heavyweight final punch here. You got to really say something so profound that then you can wrap it up. Be like the cat sitting in the sun. The cat is not trying to wrap that up, I can guarantee you. The cat is in absolutely no hurry to wrap up this experience of sitting in the sun. Just completely accepting the situation as it is. You see, our measuring minds are freaking out, saying, come on, hurry up. It's taking too long. This measurement's taking too long. We're not measuring. Not measuring. So there's part of this is uncomfortable. Uncomfortable. Again, it's hard to make, difficult to make these type of videos. Very difficult. Because I'm basically saying I'm not the one that can bring anything to an end. You see, we're all looking for a guru that can bring something to an end. It's actually, the guru is the one who truly knows. We're not trying to bring anything to an end. And I don't place myself there at this point. I'm still trying to bring this video to an end. There's part of it, I'd bring this to an end. but at least I'm in the ballpark. This is giving us a taste of the true guru, which is not trying to bring anything to an end. And I'm sure that coming across such a guru is quite an experience. I'd like to have that experience. I keep saying that. Maybe someday I will. Just in your imagination, just try to imagine what it's like if you're in the presence of the guru. Is not trying to bring anything to an end. There's no desire for any endings at all. Except a pragmatic realization that nothing never had a beginning in the first place. So, it just needs to be set down. It's not an ending. What never had a beginning doesn't have an ending. Nothing doesn't have an ending. But it's just entertaining nothing gives rise to all this. Actually, the desire for an ending gave rise to nothing. This notion of nothing. Because reality has no ending. So how can we entertain the notion of ending except through the notion of nothing? Instead of everything, the notion of nothing. See, everything doesn't have any ending. So we don't need nothing to end. We just need to choose a different idea of trying to accept reality as it is. God's non-judgment upon all forms of nothing solves the continuity issue. Okay, the sun is hitting me, my face now, full blast, but it's okay. Not in a hurry, but I'm sure we're getting antsy. We're getting antsy, saying, ah, come on, bring it mercifully to an end. Have some mercy. Have some mercy. No, we are having mercy. Abide in the endless condition. The freedom from the desire for an ending. And that's why everything is thing in itself. You're not desiring that it have an end. Whether it be a happy end or a sad end or any kind of ending at all. and thus you're savior of the world. Thus you're free to give forgiveness to everything. It's a thing. I'm not desiring any ending from you of any kind. Time, I'm not desiring that you come to an end. Now, if you're into this, you might feel like it's a strain. Like on your nerves, a strain on your nerves. The nerves are saying, well, where's the end? As if the end were somehow life. As if coming to an end is somehow life. No, life doesn't come to an end. So all this stuff here in the world is just nothing. So it's perfectly okay to see, to drop any desire for it to come to an end. It's not like it's in the way of life. Nothing is not in the way of anything. But we can use these symbols for nothing to remind us of reality. So if we say we don't have any desire for any of these symbols to come to an end, now this is a very thing than lazing a day away, entirely different. Entirely different. Because the context is satsang, sharing of truth, and we continuously reinforce that with little breaks in between to get used to this. A non-ending state. The cat moved its position. What did it do? It went back it more into the sun. Still, it's still sitting in a prime spot there. Just changed the position a little bit. Now it's doing it again. So. The end is to give up ends. Ending. The end is to give up ending. It's the ending of endingness. So we can at least we can share this, look at it, be aware of it, pay attention to it. Of course, we'll have to move on to, dinner or whatever. The issue is to practice not being in a hurry here, not trying to attain any end at all. That in itself is the attainment. But it's the attainment that is not an attainment, because there's no end to the attainment. Again, an attainment is a measurement of time and space. So this is not an attainment. It's not measurable. Like they say in the Yellow Pages advertisements, if it's not in here, it doesn't exist. As far as existence goes, if it can't be measured, it doesn't exist. Well, it doesn't exist, but it is concurrent. It's concurrent with existence. It can be concurrent with existence. And it's important to say this has always been here. This will always be here. It's always been here. It will always be here. The thing in itselfness has always been here. It always will be here. Well, the shading is working. The shading is working very well. So that's great. Don't be in any hurry here. Don't be in a hurry. Once one leaves the satsang, then there's an immersion in delusion, in endings, in measurement, in relationship, in all of that. It's like jumping into a pool, really. Once you go back to the world, it's like jumping in a swimming pool. Get completely wet. Now the practitioners who are in like monasteries and retreats and everything, that the idea is to practice this mindfulness continuously, this no endingness, this focus, no matter what you're doing during the daytime. But in regular secular society, this is not even thought about in the slightest bit. So the more we get used to this silent abidance, the closer we get to it. From my perspective, I would say, at least the way I see it now, it's more effective to pepper, salt and pepper it with some talk and some silence, some talk and silence, and never knowing when someone's going to talk or when they're going to be quiet. So there's no structure to it. See, as soon as we start structure, we start measuring. Okay, they're going to talk now, and then there's going to be silence. Okay, I've got this time and space structured. I've measured it. I've judged it. And I've got it. But when the talking and the silence is just random, you know, you don't know, then that's when it has a much, much more powerful witnessing. And as far as just going and being completely silent all the time, then again, we get into measurement and we say, okay, I've got it. They're silent all the time. I've got it. I've measured it. And by measuring, I brought an end to it. Whereas if one is just sometimes talking, sometimes not. No rhyme or reason, no plan. Then that's a totally different situation where it becomes immeasurable. And one tends to then give up trying to measure. So really, this type of presentation is very, I feel it's very, very effective, very tough, of course, because you can't measure anything. You don't know when where the end is or how it can come to an end. You can't follow the story. There's no storyline to follow. And that's what drives the part of this mind, egoic mind, crazy. It says, I can't handle this. It's terrible. So it seems to me most teachers in the world try to accommodate the ego and give a storyline, something to follow. Otherwise people just say, it's too tough for me, I can't take it anymore. But we really have to go beyond that right now. The great thing about the times that we live in is they're so terrible that we're giving thought to accepting this type of teaching. And I guess I've been trained in this because it is the type of teaching for these times, which is something I have to accept. I keep thinking that I need to do it like the way someone else did it in some previous time. No. That's not it. This is the teaching for these times. Long format. No story to it. No structure to it. Nobody knows what I'm going to do next. I don't even know what I'm going to do next. I don't know if I'm going to talk or not talk. No desire for it to be any particular way at all. Untested, there's no test. That also drives the mind, the egoic mind, crazy. The egoic mind says, well, how can I demonstrate that I've been measuring all these endings here accurately if you don't give me a test? So it is powerful teaching, super effective, but tough, difficult. And yet here we are in a time, again, ask yourself, do you want to have your future recommended for you? The future is going to say, this is your future because you did this, this, this in the past. Here is the future we recommend for you. As a matter of fact, here is that future for you. See, all of this data collecting that's going on in the world, it's a justification for telling you what your future must be. It's going to say, well, we're not being mistaken because you did all this stuff in the past that we have recorded everything you've done. Therefore, how can you disagree with the future we're recommending for you because it's in line with what you've done in the past? So we're not being totalitarian. We're being helpful. Do you see that? How all of this is going to be sold, the future, totalitarian future is going to be sold to us as something very helpful and not totalitarian at all. In fact, those who say it is, they say that you're crazy, crazy. No, we're just being super helpful. But who's to say that everything that we've done in the past is something we really wanted? Who's to say that? Where's that assumption coming from? Maybe the stuff we've done in the past, we hated it. And we felt that we're being pressured into it. Or maybe we're just putting on an act, putting on a facade. That's not what we wanted at all. So this assumption that all these page views, everything we're doing is somehow how we want the future to be, is utter nonsense. Total nonsense. And where is that in that algorithm? Where is there for the recognition of truth to stop praying for endings altogether? There's no accommodation for that whatsoever. Whatsoever. Mathematics makes no accommodation for itself vanishing, being unnecessary. Mathematics is all about endings. 1 is 1, 2 is 2, 3 is 3, 5 times 10 is 50. That brings an end to the calculation. So again, do you want your future to be handed to you, recommended to you, based on the data harvesting that's going on? Because that's what's happening. That's what's going to happen. Or you could give up. See, it's still, you could give up endings altogether. And therefore, why do you need anything recommended to you? Everything is thing in itselfness already. You know, the sun still gets very powerful. It's still strong. It's just not quite as glary. Maybe I could double up this thing. I could try that, doubling it up. Yeah. It's still a little strong, the sun coming through now directly. So there's a reason for the seemingly torturous long-form videos. There's a reason for it. Because we can, from here, we can go into no endings at all. How about no endings at all? How much time does that take? Does it take time at all? Is there a need for time? When there's no endings at all, is there a need for time? The best satsangs are the ones that are most torturous, absolutely. In a good way. Whereas you don't know where they're going or where they'll end, and there doesn't seem to be any desire for it to go anywhere and anywhere. And this is like, it's like cooking. You get like you're being barbecued. It's like, wow. And you just hang in there, hang in there, hang in there. And afterwards, you know, at some point, you just say, wow. Wow, that was, I felt something there that was, I don't feel in other situations. I feel cooked. It's like a cooking process. And we want to take our pot off the fire, you know, let it cool down. No, just let it stay there, let it simmer, let it cook. Part of you is simmering with upset, saying, where's the endings? Where's the end? Where's the story? Where's the storyline? Where's the measurements? Where's the judgment? It's like we're microwaving the mind. The guru is the microwave. And we're all in a microwave. Getting microwaved. I don't see the microwaves. There's no path, no story, no ending. It's microwaving. As Christian Murray would say, no path. There's no truth. There's a pathless land. There's no path to it. There's no path to it. So we're practicing no path here. There's no path to truth. It's already concurrent. No ending. How can there be a path if there's no ending? It's funny. It's like I'm just listening to this myself, just like you are. I'm like in the same position as you are, just listening to this, except I'm doing the one doing the speaking. But it's like something is speaking from the standpoint of truth, and then I'm listening to it, to this, but I'm not in that truth. I'm being microwaved by it. It's like Ananda Mahima said, she was the guru, the aspirant, and the initiation all in one. Now, it may be that that's what's going to happen here. I don't know. I don't have any notion that any I'm ever going to meet any guru, really. It's never happened. In the world, I just can't seem to come across them externally. This speech, I'm being affected by it profoundly and listening to it as an aspirant, you know, as a devotee of one who wants to know. So I'm like participating in the satsang too. Don't be in a hurry. Let yourself be microwaved. And you say, this microwaving is going to go on forever. There's no ending to it. And you say, if there's no ending to this, why does there need to be ending to anything? Let's just accept no ending to everything. No ending. No endingness. What's the problem with that? That just reminds us of reality, which means we don't need hypotheticals. No need for any endings. No need for anything to end. So we can practice that. And again, practice it in ways that you don't expect it. Again, the desire for ending is what brings suffering. When we accept no ending at all, there's no suffering. Frees us from suffering. Everything is thing in itself, not subject to any ending. Not subject to even any modification of its unendingness. At some point, one gets hungry and they say, okay. So we can sense there is a condition that we can experience. There is this condition. The condition of the gurus is a condition that we can experience. Absolutely. It's there. It's absolutely there. We have to keep reminding ourselves this is not a pipe dream. Not a pipe dream at all. Give up the desire for endings, and there it is. How difficult is that? There's another way of saying it is love it the way it is. Thaddeus Goal is a lazy man's little guide to enlightenment. Love it the way it is. It means give up the desire for endings. Any ending at all. But the term love it the way it is, it's kind of a pop, you know, formula. It does become sort of just a pop spirituality. That really came from drug trips in the 60s and 70s. And the problem is they're loving the drug trip the way it is. And it comes to an end, you see. That was the problem. That was a big, big problem. Something that they didn't quite realize. So then they had to have another drug trip so they could love the drug trip the way that it is and feel like, hey, I don't want anything to, nothing needs to come to an end. This is just great. Let everything stay this way. Well, of course, the drugs wear off and it all comes to an end, you see. It's a shortcut that doesn't work. It frustrates. And you know, most of those people actually flipped over into becoming very acquisitive, chasing after all sorts of endings. They wanted to own all endings. really, a lot of the heavy drug users became very materialistic. They said, "Well, I can't. These drug trips kept coming to an end. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to own all the endings." I'm going to own them all. I'm going to acquire them all. I'm going to have them all. All these things. But some people from the 60s, 50s, 60s, 70s are still hanging in there trying to accept the concurrent, unconditional, flawless, eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, the unendingness, vision of unendingness. The bliss still hanging in there till being willing to be microwaved without the drugs, you see. And realizing that they need to do it soon because the future is not what it used to be. And our future is recommended for us already. I tell you this, our future is already recommended for us. And it'll be handed to us. So here is the future that we recommend to you. And we recommend that you accept our recommendations. And for those who don't accept the recommendations, they also have recommendations for those who don't accept the recommendations. They say, well, you don't want to accept our recommendations. Well, we recommend that then you do this. You see, you say, well, I don't accept that either. It says, well, we recommend that you accept our recommendations for your non-acceptance of our recommendations. In fact, we so highly recommend it for you that here it is. We're going to give it to you anyway. give it to you anyway. So, we want to be free of endings, free of recommendations. Non-judgment doesn't have any recommendations. It's already concurrent. But it inherently brings this the isness thing in itselfness, this blessing, this saving of the world, this perfect forgiveness. It that's how it is experienced as bliss. It's not recommending any future at all. Future, no endings. How is no endings a future? Because nothing is ending right now. It's more of a timelessness, isn't it? And people go to satsangs, like, okay, well, where's my enlightenment? Where's my ending? Where's my experience of ending? This coming to an end, where's my path coming to an end? How can there be a path if there's no end? See, we conceptualize enlightenment as something that can be measured, an ending, an end. Measurement means end, right? If something's endless, how can you measure it? Something's endless, how can it be measured? This sun thing is still. So, we really, when we say enlightenment, we want something that can be measured. And if something that can't be measured, we say, how can that be our enlightenment? Because how could there be a path to it? How could there be measure? If it can't be measurable, it can't be anything. Or it can be everything. Everything in itselfness. It can only be everything in itselfness. All symbols would have to be seen as thing in itselfness, with no ending at all, no path to be what it is, nothing measurable. It's good that this hasn't dropped out yet, because that would bring an end to it. We're not seeking an end to it. Again, this is just torture, it's just practice. This is not, you know, we understand this is practice. We have to go through this. We have to go through this microwaving. Because ultimately nothing needs to be said. There's no path. Truth has no path to it. There's no end to it. There's no beginning to it. How can there be a path if there's no beginning and no end? Krishnamurti, again, truth is a pathless land. It is pathless. It is pathless, entirely pathless. If it's pathless, so what's the hurry? Where are we going? Everything is unmeasurable already. Everything already has no beginning or no ending. Everything is thing in itself. And you could say there's no beginning to enlightenment because there's no ending. It's not measurable. It's the acceptance of the, whoa, the immeasurable. Oh, you see, this shade helps because it just got blown up and lifted up and the sun hit directly. And then it washed everything out. So it is helping, actually. It actually is helping. Well, I probably want to get in before the mosquitoes come out. You see, doing this is it doesn't mean we need to be stupid, right? We're not practicing stupidity. No. If the mosquitoes descend on me, I'm out of here. Again, we're only working on the continuity. We don't have to constantly work on continuity. We're not trying to turn practice into the answer itself. No, 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 no. So, of course, we will at some point, we'll click, you know, finish on this. It'll do it itself after 3 hours. It will stop automatically. So, but again, it's practice. We understand that. We're not practicing stupidity here. We're just practicing not having any linear ending to this. Where is it going? Where's the story? Where's the beginning? Where's the ending? What are we getting at? It's hot today. That's the sweat and moving. It's warm today in California, I'm telling you. It's been a warm, warm, warm spring and already. And like again, I think it's going to be a blistering hot year around the globe. Just blistering hot. You see, that's the air conditioner that's going on right now. The inland heat is rising rapidly. It's so hot. Hot air rises. Hotter it is, the faster it rises. Because it gets very light because it's moving fast. It's moving fast. Has less density. So the hot air rises. And when the hot air rises, it creates like a vacuum effect. And it sucks in air from around it. Which is why you get thunderstorms and cyclones of the sucking in of the air as the hot air rises, creates a cyclonic movement. Whereas here in the Bay Area, when the inland air, hot air rises, it is pulling in air from where? Well, from the ocean. So you get this, whoo, you know, strong, cool air, and you get the fog, it sucks in the fog. Which is why tomorrow it probably will be foggy. Because we have this temperature differential between the coast, which is near the very cold Pacific, and the inland area, the hot inland area, we get these afternoon breezes like this. And the breezes can feel fairly cool, actually. Like Romano would just sit, and people wondering where's the end? Where's he going with this? He's not going anywhere with it. So that's very tough. People would come and just sit Every day he's just sitting quietly, just sitting. He's not trying to do something. He's not trying to not do something. He might get up, he might walk, he might eat, he might do that, or he might not. That's why people want structure, you know, in satsang, okay, retreats, okay, it's very structured. We're going to do from you know, 7:30 to 8, get up and do this, and meditation, from 8:30 to 9, this, and 9:30 to 10:30, this, and then 10:30 to 2:30, this, and going here. So it's all these endings, it's all these paths, it's all this structure. That's why people love that, and they say, wow, I'm really being very spiritual, because this is all measured out. So now I get it. I get spirituality. I get it. So I must be close to enlightenment because I'm getting it. No, no, it's the opposite. You're losing it. You're missing it. Missing it. It gives the illusion of getting it, because you measured it all out. You've taken the measure of it, time and space. You now get it. You see how it works. You see how the retreat works. You don't see how what you really want is. You don't see the vision of thing in itself, isness. You're not abiding in that, which has no story to it, which has no measurement to it, which is free of limits, safe, healed, and whole, free to forgive, free to save the world. Spirit am I. We are spirit. What do we know of limitations, of endings? Yeah, people get the retreat figured out. They say, okay, this teacher, okay, I know they're going to end at 6 o'clock. It's over, and then we go to get some food, and then the retreat's over. So I got it. And wow, I feel so at one with my understanding. I feel so advanced. I feel so progressive. I feel so superior, so special. Now I know. See, now I know something very important. I know how it's structured. And it's been a successful retreat. Successful according to who? Or what? Success is not something that can be measured. The immeasurable is success. The immeasurable is what we really want. God's perfect non-judgment. What is there to measure? How can it be measured? It's endless, eternal, seamless. What is there to be measured? It defies measurement. It's always not judging the one doing the measuring. It's not judging any measurement. That which judges no measurement, how can it be measured? Again, no need to draw conclusions. We're not trying to draw conclusions. which is again another measurement. We're just open to that which doesn't need time or space. You could say the disappearance of time and space, but it concurrently is the appearance of thing in itself, isness. So there's a concurrency there. But time and space is also doesn't come to an end, so it doesn't really disappear. It's just reinterpreted. It's perceived correctly. It's perceived in a meaningful way. It's the only meaningful perception there is of symbols. It's as a continuity device, a reminder of reality. That's the only meaningful perception that could possibly be. And to those who want to get it, you know, measure it and get an A on the test, it's tough, isn't it? Because who knows what I'm saying or when am I going to say it or anything like that, and I don't even remember what I said. There's no test. It's like the breeze. You know, the breeze comes, the breeze goes. You just sit in the breeze. It's like sitting in the breeze here. You're not trying to get anything. You're just sitting in the breeze, and you're getting used to sitting in the breeze. Admittedly difficult in today's culture, but also admittedly essential. That's why the Holy Spirit keeps telling me, come on, come on, come on, keep doing it, come on, come on, come on, you can do it, come on, don't give up, don't go play golf, do the taping. It's more profound. Golf is often something you do when you don't know what to do. I mean, you just feel like, wow, I just can't figure out what to do. But the Holy Spirit said, do some taping. Give it a try here. The capacity to just sit quietly and observe is the highest capacity. You know, a great exercise would be to sit like in a place in the shade where you can observe the sun, and just sit all day and just observe the sun, be aware of it moving, its movement, the entire day from dawn to sunset. Just observe it. Don't try to figure anything out. Just be aware of it. In the past, people would have to take the time to be aware, and they had much greater wisdom, actually. It wasn't difficult to say, let's just sit here. A lot of times, people would sit quietly for decades. There are quite a few, quite a few, quite a few who accepted no endings. They had the continuity issue resolved for them. Quite a few throughout history. We're not even aware of it in today's day and age. Most of their names are never recorded. The way they related was very different, actually, than now. But we're here now. This is our situation, so we have to, be microwaved here with this non-endingness. The thing in itselfness. And Jesus assures us that this thing in a selfness is absolutely beautiful beyond measure, because it's not measurable. That which can't be measured is certainly, in other words, vastly preferable over to measurableness, because measurableness is always just of a symbol of nothing. And it's always measuring some non-life, is measuring death, is impermanence, death, is measuring death, is what it's doing. It's measuring death. All measurement is measurement of death. So the immeasurable, we definitely can accept the immeasurable, which is always concurrent. It's always been concurrent with measuring. The immeasurable has always been and is and always will be concurrent with measuring. That's an even smoother way of saying it. The measureless is concurrent with measuring. Measurelessness is concurrent with measuring. The immeasurable is here concurrent with our measuring. Symbols are neutral, you see. You can either see them as measureless or measurable. All symbols are neutral. Just made up, imagine. They're all neutral. So we can see them as immeasurable or measurable. It's entirely up to us. We just can't see them as both. How can we see them as both? Both measurable and immeasurable is not possible. So it's up to us. We're either seeing symbols as measurable or immeasurable. It's entirely up to us. We're assuming that they're all measurable, that there's this process going on. It's assumption for the purpose of measuring. We're measuring the process. If we didn't see any process, really realize we don't know nothing to measure. Everything is thing in itself. Thus, so we presume that, yeah, this is all process is taking place, and not just moment by moment by moment freshness, free and clear of any process. Just like we assume that a movie is seamless, and we don't realize it's frame by frame just going quickly. The immeasurable does not refer to something huge. No, it refers to right now, timelessness, thing in itselfness, seeing symbols as having no end, no measurability to them. It's not referring to something like an ocean, oh, the immeasurable. We think the immeasurable, we say, oh my gosh, you're talking about the cosmos or something. No, we're talking about everything, thing in itselfness. A speck of dust can be seen as immeasurable, just the same as an ocean. No difference to its immeasurableness. No ending, no beginning, no ending. No relationship. Everything is thing in itselfness. It's just a symbol with unjudged, entirely unjudged. The same as all other symbols, entirely unjudged. No measurability there. So it's immeasurable. So that's very important to recognize it. Not talking about scale. We're talking about immeasurable. We're not just a way to refer to something enormous. Not at all. Not at all. It's not that there's some enormous space. Okay? The enormity has no place in the immeasurable. No place at all. So it's not some great space. That's always like frightened me. Great space, what are you talking about? No. Not some great space at all. It's neither great space nor small space. It's not like that at all. And that should take a great deal of fear out of the situation. Yeah, that's one of the big blocks that I've noticed, is the way of teaching is trying to use a metaphor for this immeasurability. The metaphor is some vastness or something. No, there's no vastness. There's no greatness or vastness. It's neither vast nor not vast. It's just right here, right now, immeasurable. No beginning, no ending. If something has no beginning or ending, how can it be vast? Or how can it be not vast? You know, not small. How can it be big or small? Those are measurements. It is simply thing in itselfness. It is simply isness. Isness is neither vast nor not vast, nor in between. It's some different quality. It's an immeasurable quality, the quality of immeasurability. Again, immeasurability doesn't refer to space, anything spatial. You can say this speck of dust cannot be measured, it's immeasurable. There's nothing to measure. Because it's has no beginning and has no ending. It has no story. It's what it is-ness. And that's all that it is. So everything, regardless of its size, has the same is-ness. So the is-ness is ever-present. The sky has the same is-ness as a speck of dust. And the location, that over there, far away, has the same isness as that close here. That in the past has the same isness as that in the future, as it were. That which is vivid is the same isness as that which is muted. So no difference in scale. That big mountain has the same isness as this little computer. And that over there, that star, has the same isness as this plant here. No difference at all. In scale, time frame, anything like that. It's immeasurable. And I've forgotten what I what I've said earlier on in this video, which is fine, because again, this is all microwaving us. Doesn't matter. So how did I feel at the microwave, you know, time 1 hour? I don't know. I don't remember. How do I, you know, what did we say an hour ago? I don't know. Doesn't matter. It's a cumulative effect. Microwaving is a cumulative effect, gradually raising the temperature, as it were. We're gradually getting used to this. We've gained greater depth by getting to this, saying it's not a spatial thing, it's not a scale thing, it's not a distance. That's very important, actually, to see that. That's very important. You could call that a breakthrough, a real breakthrough. Removes an enormous amount of fear, an enormous block. Removes the fear of being overwhelmed. It turns our attention in some other direction, doesn't it? It's like, hey. Hey, maybe this experience, this immeasurableness is like really wonderful. It's not overwhelming. It's like completely present. There's this complete presence and you can't go anywhere in it. You can't lose it. It's not scaled. It's not overwhelming. It's perfect. It's like gently present, like a portable paradise. No sense of being overawed by it at all. All right, well, here come the dog walkers. There's a lot of traffic on the street. Almost always walking the dog. That's what's totally in these days, is you got to have a dog and you got to walk the dog. That's exercise. You know, it's an excuse for exercise. It's a good excuse, actually. You know, it's quite smart, because in today's life, you know, it's just like, what can we do? So much stress. Usually, for most of us, all we can do is walking is our exercise, which I don't do enough of. I don't do it because I still want to run and I can't run. Wears me out too bad. So. People get a dog. What does the dog want to do every evening? Wants to go on a walk. In fact, the dog insists. It's a trainer. It's like an exercise trainer. It'll bark and whine and cause you guilt and everything if you don't take it on a walk. So you say, oh my God, I've got to take the dog on a walk. So you go out and take your walk. I mean, the dog should be charging us, you know, $50 an hour for this service, really. Of course, it gets free room and board, so that's payment. And it gets to go on those mind-blowing trips where the windows roll down and its nose and it's going whoosh past everything and it's like smelling everything, quantum speed, and the dog's blowing the dog's mind, totally. Hard to say what's going through a dog's mind, but they're just getting all this huge, overwhelming palette of smells as it goes driving through, you know, the neighborhood, and it's just like, wow. It's like a drug for the dog. I think that's the dog's drug, is going on trips like that with the window rolled down. Well, probably want to get out of Dodge while the getting is good before the mosquitoes come. How we doing? Ah, wow. It didn't drop out, which is very, very nice. Very, very successful. In the evening time, it's just terrible problems, I'm telling you. Whew. At midnight, it always goes out. Midnight, it always goes out. I almost always just boom, around midnight, just drops connection. Absolute internet just goes out. And recently, it's getting worse and worse and worse. Starts dropping out at 7 o'clock. Just terrible. And we're supposed to have the best, you know, wireless around, but awful. What you gonna do? Make adjustments. Tape earlier. The good thing about taping earlier, I get to watch the Giants game tonight. I get to see if Lincecum is going to have a terrible year or a good year. That's interesting. But in the meantime, we've spent this time not getting used to not spending time. The measurable, being immeasurable, not worrying about measuring anything. What needs to be measured in hypotheticals? What is the end game about measurement? What is the end game? What is the end game? Think about that. Exactly what is the end game here of all this measurement? Is there an end game? Does he or she who has the most measurements win? What do they win? Do they have the continuity problem solved for them? I mean, what do you do with hypotheticals? When you win, what do you do with them? Think about that, right? What is the end game of measurement? More measurement. And what's the end game of that? More measurement. And what's the end game of that? More measurement. So it's just like this endless circular thing, isn't it? It's circular. It's like a rat on a cage. It doesn't. There is no end game to it except to give up measurement. And we can do that right now because God has never measured hypotheticals. And it's given us this permanent, eternal, seamless, concurrent non-measurement, non-judgment, non-judgment, non-measurement of all hypotheticals. God is never going to measure hypotheticals. Reality doesn't need to measure anything. And only reality is real. There is nothing outside of reality. Reality is all there is. We can wish that there's something else, but there isn't. Wishing doesn't make it so. Imagining, dreaming, what-ifing doesn't make it so. But our what-ifing can be very creative and imaginative, of course. And it is. But doesn't make it real, doesn't make it so. So, there's already the immeasurable. The non-measurement is already present for us to abide in. Cooling down. So we're practicing. We're not trying to get something else. We're not trying to get anything. We're just hearing this. We're just letting it sink in, as it were. Saying, hey. Not trying to reach a conclusion, an end point with it. Getting used to having no end point to it. Getting used to not getting it. See, we're not getting it. But that is getting it. That's paradoxical. By not getting it, we're getting it. Because there is no end to it. There's no getting to it. There's no beginning, no end. So we're comfortable with that. with no measurement. Getting means a measurement. When we're comfortable with not getting it, that is the getting of it. And we try to outsmart ourselves by thinking by not getting it, we're getting it the opposite way. That by pretending that we are, that we want to make sure that we don't get it, so we don't practice. They say, oh no, see, I'm not getting it. But the paradox is you have to practice not getting it. You don't not get it by not practicing not getting it, because then you're still trying to get it, actually. It's continuing on with your measurement and getting. So it's important to practice not getting it. So after this video is over, you'll say, I didn't get it. Yeah. But a lot of practice and not getting it. There's nothing to get. There's no measurement to get. Getting implies measurement. Something being modified. I get this is not this, but everything in itself, what is there to get? As far as change. There you go. Recording limit. Nearing recording limit. Oh, they give you a warning. Okay. Very good. Nearing recording limit. So when you say, I didn't get it, don't get that either. I don't get that I didn't get it. I didn't get that I didn't get it. Say that. I don't get that I don't get it. And I don't get that. I don't get that I don't get it. I don't get it that I don't get it. 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 I don't get that immeasurability doesn't relate to size. I don't get it. In other words, I don't measure it. I don't have a measurement for that. I don't have any measurements. I failed in all these measurements. I don't have the measurements here. I spent all this time in the video. I don't have the measurements for it. I don't even get that. I don't have the measurements for it. I don't even have the measurements for not having the measurements. I don't have the measurements for that either. And that's okay. Don't need any measurements. Don't need to get anything. What does reality need to get? I need to get something. I need to get it. What is reality asking itself? What is reality? I don't get it. No. I don't get it. It looks like the technology is recommending a future for us right now. And its recommended future for us is that we stop the broadcasting right now. You see, that's the recommended future that it's giving to us. So when in Rome, do as Romans do. Now if I recorded straight to disk, I could keep on going and keep on going and keep on going, and I may do that at some point. So there is no recommended limit for us, even though the hard disk recommends a limit for us too. Just remember, spirit am I, holy Son of God, free without limits, safe, healed and whole, free to forgive.